Well, good morning, beloved children of God. All right. Right now, turn around and to the people that you're seated in front of, behind, or on the side, and tell them how glad you are to see them this morning. All right. And now I'd like to bring some clarification about my time away. For clergy in the United Methodist Church, the Book of Discipline allows us that once every 4 years, we get to take 4 weeks off for some kind of renewal time or spiritual formation or something like that. It's to be restful and not to be counted as vacation. So, I have decided to go to Ashland, Oregon, and to attend the United Bicycle Institute and learn about preaching to bicycles. Or, I should say, learn all about bicycles so that while I'm riding, I can be preaching to people I pass by. But anyway, I'm looking forward to this time, and I think that you'll find that when I get back, I'll even be more full of more energy than I even have right now. Okay? You will have some quality people. Reverend James O'Neill will be here to preach two Sundays with Reverend Cheryl Winterset. She lives in Heber. She helps out with the Holbrook United Methodist Church two Sundays a month, but she'll be here for one. And then our superintendent, Reverend Melissa Reinders, will be here for one of the Sundays. So you'll be well taken care of. All right? Good. So now, friends, as we worship God this morning, let's make sure we give God our best. Amen? Amen. And now I invite you to stand as you're able as we begin our singing.
Like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your soul. Giving God, we gather today to celebrate the resurrection of your Son. We are grateful for the new life he brings. We are grateful for the hope and the joy he shares. We are grateful for leading the way as he goes before us. Gracious God, today and every day, we offer you our thanks and praise. Strengthen our faith, that it may sustain us during difficult days and enable us to share your love with others. Open our hearts to new life and new possibilities. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading today is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. Blessed be the God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. May the church hear what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell us. Amen.
Lamb of God, the Christ, the Anointed One, won't you enter my heart today? Oh, please hear my prayer, Hosanna, these words that I need to say. Gentle Lamb of God, the Christ, the Anointed One, won't you enter my heart? Thank you. anointed one, won't you enter my heart today? Oh, please hear my prayer, Hosanna. These words that I need to say, gentle Lamb of God, the Christ, the anointed one, won't you enter?
Well, the sermon series, Living with Hope. Sermon series continues. There was a man driving down the road and he hit the Easter Bunny. You don't want to hear that one again, right? No. William Barclay, the beloved Scottish theologian and Bible teacher, was rather hard of hearing, and he relied on lip reading when he was very close to people. But when he was far away, it was very hard for him to make out the words. So after preaching in a Glasgow church one day, Barclay was greeting at the door when a man came up to him and shook his hand and he said, Dr. Barclay, I want to thank you for saving my life. Well, I'm sorry, he replied, because he was really baffled. He says, I just don't remember. Well, one evening about a year ago, I was sitting on the steps next to the church. And I yelled out to you as you walked out to the church, I yelled this, life is terrible, and I'm going to throw myself and drown in the river. And you walked by and said, yeah, that sounds good. Have a nice day. May it go well for you. That comment, he said, brought me back to reality. So I realized that killing myself would be foolish, and today life is good. All right? Life is good because of the resurrection of Jesus. And Peter is writing now to bring reality back to the churches in what is now Turkey so that they could kind of get back and get hope in their lives and joy again. Now, these churches were formed mostly from pagans. They came from pagan religions. They worshiped the Greco-Roman gods. They may have heard of Judaism, but for the most part, these were people who heard about the love of Jesus and decided to surrender their lives to Jesus, become a part of the church. But there was an issue. A problem was that when they did this, they lost a lot of their pagan friends. So imagine now that you come to church and people know you come to this church and they start to ignore you. Or they might start to throw tomatoes at you or something like that or insult you. You might have to hide. You might have to not be out and about. You might have to take a different way to get to the grocery store if they'll even let you buy groceries. But that's just the way it was turning out. So Peter is trying to help them to understand, well, in the midst of all these struggles, there still can be joy that is found, that is found. So the first thing reminds them about the blessed God of Jesus, the blessed one who is worthy to be venerated. Again, remind them, this God is different from those Greco-Roman gods. This God is the one who sent his son Jesus into the world so that the world might come and be saved through him, all right, and to share the love of God. So this love involves now, this love that comes flowing from God through Jesus, it gives new birth. And when things are new, we get started, we're excited about things when things are new. So this new birth brings a living hope to all who experience the grace that is brought to the world through Jesus. So this is the fullness of joy, that grace. This is the joy that Peter hopes that the churches now in this area of the world, that they can experience and then hold on to again. They can hold on to it. Now, the one thing to clarify is that hope is not about thinking that we can escape trials and tribulations from this life, all right? Hope is having the confidence and trust in Jesus that we can face trials and tribulations and make it through them, whatever they may be. We don't have to give up. We can always go forward, always go forward. Our inheritance, it talks about, signifies that we are part of the family called the church. And as family, we need to gather at times to help others in our family that are in great need. So that's the other encouragement that's going on here. And ultimately, the inheritance we also share as a family is that great, great reward of eternal life. All right? Because of that, we now can find a calmness in our lives. At least I believe there should be a calmness about this. There's nothing to fret about anymore. Well, there are things to fret about, but they shouldn't be weighing us down, all right? They should not be weighing us down. So here's an example of finding calmness. It's an excerpt from an old Celtic poem entitled Beannacht. It's part of it. It was a blessing by a John O'Donohue, and it's about a person who going out on a boat, and it mentions a curragh, which is a small animal hide boat that was used by the ancient Celts to cross the Irish Sea. So it goes like this. On the day when the weight deadens on your shoulders and you stumble, may the clay dance to balance you. When the canvas frays in the curragh of thought and the stain of the ocean blackens beneath you, may there come across the waters a path of yellow moonlight to bring you safely home. May the nourishment of the earth be yours. May the clarity of light be yours. May the fluency of the ocean be yours. And may the protection of the ancestors be yours. A perfect poem. There's more to it than that, but that just kind of highlights the act of being encouraged to get through things, to get through, and especially crossing perhaps the Irish Sea. So Peter is encouraging the churches now to live in hope, to be filled with hope, and to be filled with joy. We all need encouragement at times, don't we? And especially we need encouragement when things aren't going well for us. So it's said that when money was short and things weren't going so well with the Catholic worker movement in the early 1900s, Dorothy Day, who was a wonderful saint, would encourage her staff by praying, "O Lady of Cana, send us some wine." Only one person got it, I think. Explain after the worship service. Friends, we can get buried with life problems. We know people who get buried with life problems. The Christians in Peter's life again had problems. And we can feel out of sorts. But when we feel out of sorts, we need to feel validated that somehow people understand I am feeling out of sorts. All right? Peter shares that our struggles help us to be refined. Okay? It's not that we get burned, but it's a refining process that the troubles being tested by fire, that the troubles can help us to engage life in a better way and perhaps even a better way when the next set of troubles come. But we should know that God does not test us, okay? There are far too many opportunities in life to bring the tests upon us without God helping, all right? But Peter also reminds us by holding fast to the faith, the outcome, the final outcome, he says, and that is our place with God in heaven someday, all right? So whatever troubles we face, we got that hope to cling on to, all right? There's an old story about an artist who could observe from his studio window a panhandler plying his trade each day, and he decided the man whose shoulders drooped down and whose eyes were downcast and sad would make an interesting portrait study. So he painted this man from a distance. When he finished, he took the portrait outside and showed it to the panhandler to see what he thought of it. "Who's that?" the man asked. to him, the painting bore a slight resemblance to himself, but what he saw on the canvas was different. Here on the canvas was a person of dignity, with an upright posture, with bright eyes. Why, the man in the painting was almost handsome. Is that really me? The panhandler asked. I don't look like that, do I? But the artist replied, I paint what I see, and this is the person I see in you. There are people in the world out there to be needed to be seen and told that they are precious, that this is how I see you. People, sometimes they are around in the world with droopy shoulders, sad eyes, and sad faces, but somebody needs to come and lift their spirits up. Lift their spirits up like this artist did. Because everyone in the world, everyone is a precious child of God. And we can be great encouragers and help them to discover the joy to experience the love of Jesus, just like we experience the love of Jesus. From Homiletics Online, these authors, Stan Purdom and Carl Wilton, share this story. Whoops, I messed it up, didn't I, Bobby? So what's the opposite of being an encourager? Being overcritical, dismissive, and disparaging, among other things. And sometimes it helps us to change when we realize what we are doing. A man we'll call Dwayne tells of sitting in a restaurant with his grown son. When the son was a teenager, he had gotten into an argument, into drugs and bad company, created a lot of stress in the family and the anxiety of his parents. So the father and son were both strong-willed. Do any of us have strong-willed children? Yes. And had often been at loggerheads during those years. But somehow the son had gotten through his problems and eventually, as a grown-up, began to be a contributing member of society. So while Dwayne and his son were waiting for their meals to arrive, they noticed an elderly couple come in and sit down at a nearby table. The woman was overweight and appeared to be at least 80, but she was dressed like a cowgirl of 20 with a red Stetson, a Western outfit, and boots, and she also had a bit of glitter jewelry. So Dwayne started to make a snarky remark about her appearance to his son, but his son stopped him, saying, "Don't, Dad. Life is hard enough wearing what makes her feel good. That's why she's wearing it, that outfit. And we're not perfect either." So the father was smart enough to shut up and realize that his son was the one seeing things clearly. Dwayne became even more convinced that the next day, while reading some devotional material, he came across these words from Ephesians, "Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear." That's from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. So a few days after that, Dwayne was sitting in a physical therapy facility, waiting for his turn for therapy for a minor foot problem. While there, an older woman entered, moving slowly, aided by a walker and wincing in obvious pain. She asked, the two began to talk, and she asked Dwayne what he was there for. And so he told her about his foot, and then she described the much more debilitating condition that she was experiencing and how surgery had not helped as much as she had hoped. She explained that she was now relying on the therapy that she was receiving, but that caused significant pain. Wearily, she added, "I don't know how much more of this I can take." And at that moment, Dwayne's therapist stepped into the room and told him that she was ready for him, and for some reason, as he got up, Dwayne recalled his son's comment in the restaurant, and then he turned back toward this woman and said, "Don't give up. You can do this. God bless you." A simple statement of encouragement from a man who wanted to criticize a woman who was dressed to make herself feel good. So friends, everybody needs encouragement at times, right? We all do. Peter was wanting to do this for the people of his church. He wants to encourage us as well to do the same thing. Like Dwayne, we can use a simple phrase, "Don't you give up, you can do this, God bless you." We can create our own helpful phrases for people who need to hear good things, maybe during bad times. So, the people in our world need encouragement. And as since we now are the Easter people filled with joy, with hope, and with love, we are the ones that are ready to go, right? To get out there and share the good news and be people who can provide encouragement for all that we meet. Are you with me on this?
Yes.
Outstanding. Amen. Before the prayer, I'd like to share the joy that my father-in-law is out of the hospital. Things are going well. The plumbing seems to be working for him. He's just feeling some weak, so I encouraged him to get out and start walking. He used to play golf every day, and when I was there on Saturday, and his place is near the sixth hole, so he was out there watching his friends that he normally plays with trying to put him in the hole. One guy did it well, the other guy not so well. But anyway, but I really appreciate your love and care for him and for my family, and we need some more prayers to help him get strong again, all right? So let's now sing ourselves into this time of prayer. Oh, beloved God, it is another beautiful day to come into your house of worship, that we can indeed be here to worship. As the scripture reminds us that you indeed are blessed, the creator of all things, not only of this world, but in all the world's whole universe. was made by your hand. Your grace exudes through every molecule that we inhale. Your grace exudes in everything that we do. Always, God, please help us to understand that and to rejoice in that. We still celebrate the resurrection of your Son in this season of Easter. And how wonderful that is, that we know that death is not the end, but new life. As the Apostle Paul reminds us, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? It stings no more. Because of your great love for your Son, your great love for each and every one of us. Oh God, as we come to this church to worship, we also come to pray. And some of us have things on our hearts of loved ones or situations in the world that we wish to share. And so please now listen to what those names and concerns may be. And so God, you've heard, spoken out loud, names. We ask that you bring the right blessings that are needed for them. But we know that some things were lifted to you silently, and we ask the same. But as we look to our world, we know that there are people that are in need of healing in many ways, from physical ailments, emotional, spiritual. Please bless them. And we're aware, too, of weird weather that happens that brings destructions to people's lives. And so there are people still recovering from tornadoes, floods. Please help with the rebuilding of lives that is needed. And we know that there are people in hospital beds, people in care facilities. Again, help them. And for the wars that never end, Ukraine, Sudan, and other places, violence, help that to end as well. Rise up peacemakers and help warring parties to make peace. And God, we take time again to thank you. Thank you for this time of worship, to hear your word read and proclaimed, and to sing praises to you as we offer this prayer to you in the name of Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit live and reign, one God forever and ever. Amen. Now is the time to celebrate our offering. You've had the opportunity even before the service to put it in the basket, but there's an opportunity after as well. So let's please join me together in our prayer for our offering taken this day. Holy and loving God, you treat us not like the stern disciplinarian, but like the forgiving parent who runs to embrace us when we've rebelled or disappointed. Your mercy gives us the opportunities to try again, to return into your grace, to pick ourselves up and brush ourselves off. We forget how many strikes we have against us, but invite us back into the inheritance you desire for us. May our offering this day reflect our gratitude. In Christ we pray. Amen. Now please rise as you're able for our doxology.
Praise God for I
Please be seated. As we get ready to celebrate this Holy Sacrament, a reminder that you do not have to be a United Methodist or even a member of this congregation, for this is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, and it is our Lord who invites us to come to this table. Come to the table again, be filled with the Spirit that is among us. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son. We believe in the love of Christ and are thankful for the grace of God in our daily lives. We have celebrated the harvest of the field and the bounty of the land. Let us turn our attention to the fruit of the Spirit. We look for God among us, and we see his face in the eyes of those around us. Let us be the ones in whose eyes others see Christ. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to you, and then he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the new covenant of my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." We offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving for what Jesus has done for us. We remember Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be once again the body and blood of Christ, that we may be the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with the church, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Amen. And since we are the children of God, we are now bold to pray what Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The bread that we break, it is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks, it is a sharing in the blood and the compassion and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. We do have gluten-free elements at the front of the table. But friends, these are God's gifts for you, God's children. Come. pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks. Thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant now that we may go out into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Invite you to stand as you are able as we close our service. A reminder that there are goodies to have after the service. In the world out there, a lot of people need an encouraging word, an encouraging embrace perhaps. And you are the very people that can do it. I can see it in each and every one of you. So feel free to share the love of Christ with all people you meet this week. And while you're doing that, make sure you laugh a lot. Make sure you have as much fun as you can this side of the galaxy. That you enjoy life. Live in Christ. Be at peace. Now go in peace.
Trust.